Recently, videos showing the Paracas trident in Peru have been circulating on social media, claiming it as an evidence of the Ramayana. The Ramayana, an epic tale of dharma, love, duty, sacrifice, and adventure that has captivated billions for centuries in India and beyond, has left its mark across the world. Beyond India, from Indonesia and Thailand to Iran and even South America, stories of Ramayana are etched in ancient temples and monuments and found in various cultural practices. It defines and guides how man should live to sustain harmoniously with everything in nature. When we look at the Paracas trident and realize its astonishing similarity with place mentioned in Ramayana, we not only get goosebumps, we also wonder if this is really true, then other places mentioned in the Ramayana should also match. Even if we cannot find them exactly as found in Sugriv's description, because a lot of time must have passed, and history, geography, geology, etc., everything would have changed substantially. Yet, if it is true, then there must be other places or evidences for sure that can be matched with the said description by Sugriv. Whereas in Ramayana, Sugriv is the king of Vanars who were ape-like men. He helped Ram in his search of his wife Sita, who was abducted by the demon king Ravan, by sending lakhs and lakhs of Vanars in all four directions in the Kishkindha Kand of Valmiki Ramayana. In this sequence, he describes important landmarks in every directions. Here, in this video, we will try to understand places mentioned by him in East. Surprisingly, we can find almost everything mentioned by him if we go in West rather than East in today's context. Let's start. Sugriv instructs them to search in places where silkworms originate and where there are silver mines. Now we all know that silkworms originate in mulberry trees and are associated with China historically. But it's important to note that actually there are three kinds of mulberry trees. White mulberry is native to Chinese region, red mulberry is native to Central and Eastern United States, and the third one, the Morris nigra or the black mulberries, which originated in and are native to the mountainous areas of Mesopotamia and Persia. Secondly, in this verse, he also tells to look in the places which have silver mines. It is no secret that the silver is believed to have mined first in Anatolia or the Asia Minor region. Thus, he seems to direct the search towards Asia Minor region, comprising of modern-day Turkey, Iran and Iraq, which were home to mulberry trees, silkworms and silver mines historically. In the next verse, he asks them to look in the mountains which are beneath the ocean water, nearby islands and the villages atop Mandar Mountain. Here lies the largest and best known undersea mountain range, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. These are the world's longest mountain ranges, all underwater, except for few spots like Iceland. And there are a number of islands on either side of it, like Jane Mayen and Tristan da Cunha. And what to say about Mandar Mountain mentioned by him? Standing along the northern part of the Cameroon-Nigeria border in Africa, this mountain bears the same name even today. In this verse, he describes various places known for their distinctive inhabitants. In this sequence, he mentions people who have elongated earlobes, elongated lips, and people who are dark like iron, and monopods or one-legged people. We will discuss others in another video, as this video is already getting too long. He asks the Vanars to go and carefully search into the places where all these live. It seems he is referring to places in Africa and Europe. The pictures of Maasai people flashes in our mind immediately when we hear of people with elongated earlobes and elongated lips. They belong to the ancient Nilotic tribe, which still takes pride in the continuation of their ancient culture. But no. Probably, Sugriv is describing Panoti. Not just Sugriv, they were reported by different authors at different times and at different places by different names. Many ancient Roman historians and geographers, like Pliny the Elder and Nuremberg Chronicles, mentioned a race of kind people with giant ears large enough to cover their bodies. Panoti is mentioned in many ancient carvings as well. They mainly lived in Orkney Island, near Scotland, conforming to the region we are looking into. Seems Sugriv is referring to the Chopi of Mozambique and Nilotic people of Sudan, Kenya, Tanzania, etc., who are among the world's most tall, strong and dark-skinned people, when he refers next to people who are strong and dark-skinned like iron. Next, interestingly, he mentions people who have one leg, yet walk with great speed and agility. This looks totally fictitious, but there is substance to it. Here, he is referring to monopods or one-legged people who find mention throughout history in many of the ancient texts and chronicles. The Greek philosopher Apollonius of Tyana, who journeyed through the Middle East, Africa, and India, documented encounters with monopods in places like India and Ethiopia. Isidore de Seville, in his famous book Etymology, writes that the race of sauropods are said to live in Ethiopia. They have only one leg and are wonderfully speedy. The Greeks call them skypods, which means shade-footed ones, because when it is hot they lie on their backs on the ground and are shaded by the great size of their foot. Moving forward, since Sugriv is mentioning places in Africa and Europe, looks like he is mentioning Ethiopia here, where monopods live. In modern times, monopods don't exist. Yet, given the fact that, with times, everything including genetics change and species do get extinct, possibility of their existence in ancient times cannot be outrightly ruled out. In coming verses, he describes the Atlantic Ocean, other seas of the area and the mysterious Bermuda Triangle. Sugriv tells the Vanars that after that, you all will find the sweet ocean and its islands, and a roaring ocean which appears very scary because of huge waves. Here, in most probability, he is talking about Lapland Sea in the northern part of Baltic Sea, because Lapland Sea is the sweetest sea on earth because it has several fresh water rivers flowing in, and it is located in the last dip of the second largest inland sea in the world, the Baltic Sea. For scary sea, he is describing the North Sea, which is famous for having biggest rouge waves in the world. These massive waves can be incredibly daunting and awe-inspiring. He tells that in that ocean live many humongous monsters who go hungry for days and snatch living beings by their shadow. He is describing none other than the infamous Bermuda Triangle. The Bermuda Triangle, which is well known for the mysterious and unexplained disappearances of ships and planes. With great effort you can cross that ocean and you will reach Lohit Sagar. There you will see a massive tree named Koot Shalmali, which is the mark of Shalmali Island. Next he says, near that lies a beautiful palace of Vinta's son Garud, constructed by Vishwakarma. That palace is colossal like Kailash Parvat. One noteworthy point is not only in Ramayana, in Srimad Bhagavatam's also, The residence of Garud is mentioned near Shalmali trees. Taking into account all these factors, the area seems to lie near present-day Lebanon. Following points support this strongly. Number 1. Lebanon stands in the vicinity of Red Sea, known as Lohit Sagar, even in present times in India. Number 2. Sugriv mentions Kut Shalmali trees, which are huge. And Lebanon is home to one of the tallest and massive trees on earth, Cedars Libani. Commonly, they are known as Cedar of Lebanon or the Cedars of God because cedar forests were considered home of gods. The importance of these trees to this land is reflected in the national emblem and flag of Lebanon. And stands in the area, the colossal temples of Baalbek. Though it may seem nonsensical, if we say that this was the temple of Garud, yet there are strong points which speaks in its favor. First, this temple and the stones used initially in it are definitely colossal by any human standards, and its construction is still an ongoing mystery. Secondly, just like Sugriv had mentioned, this temple was constructed mostly from white granite and a rough white marble. Besides, the temple with lots of motifs like swastik, lotus has been a subject of constant debate regarding who were its original builders or it having Indian roots. Fourthly, a very interesting and mention-worthy point is, Baalbek is named after Baal, which was a title or epithet originally meaning owner. Later on, it was used to be associated with gods. Whereas Baal's widely used epithet is Rider of the Clouds, highlighting his control over the skies. Over time, in the Western world, stories and legends evolved, but this aspect of Baal is similar to Garud. 1. Who rules the skies and clouds? Fifthly, it is said that these forests and area was home to a demigod, which matches with Garud again, as he was also a demigod. Sixthly, in Lebanon and nearby countries, we find many ancient carvings and stories of massive bird-like creatures, just like Garud. Namely, Huma, Nisroch, Anju, etc. Moreover, the carvings of Garuda himself at the entrance of the temple gives us goosebumps. This colossal temple of Baalbek and its location befits aptly to the location given by Sugriv. And this is also a truth that the colossal slabs and stones and construction of Baalbek remains an unexplained riddle by any other theory. In the verse, Sugriv is telling about Mahasagar or ocean and Bardhvamukh, which means fire mouth. Here, he is referring to Pacific Ocean and its ring of fire. He says, adjacent to that ocean, there is a tall mountain on top of whom you will find Lord Anant. Although he is a serpent, yet he is stunningly beautiful like gods. That Anant Dev has thousands of foreheads. Now, before saying anything else, let's have a look at these mountain peaks in Peru of South America, adjacent to ocean, which bears the name Anant. Osjolo Anante, 5,500 meters. Saxa Ananta, 5,400 meters. Ananta, 5,300 meters. Ananta, 5,200 meters. Ananta Kucho, 5,100 meters. Cerro Ananta, 4,916 meters. Astonishing, isn't it? And there are more. The bonding of name Ananta with Peru is mind-blowing. And depiction of thousand-headed snake god, countless carvings and petroglyphs of massive snakes define the region and continent. And look at this, another unexplained mystery in Peru near Paracas Trident. Band of holes in the Serpent Mountain. What does it look like? Though we cannot declare anything, but doesn't it all fit together? Unbelievable, yet undeniable. And comes the verse describing the Paracas Trident. In these verses, Sugriv speaks of a mountain adorned with an altar bearing the emblem of Ananta, a symbol etched into the rocky face resembling a palm tree with three branches. This monumental trident, revered as the eastern compass by celestial beings, marks a sacred threshold beyond which lies the majestic Udayagiri Mountain. Here, by Udayagiri Mountains, what he is describing is the majestic Andes, the longest mountain ranges in the world. And because, if Sugriv from ancient India can describe Paracas Trident in Peru, we cannot just brush aside its purpose that he had described. So, when he says, it served as a mark of direction by gods or devtas, it infers that there were gods who drove Vimanas. Surprisingly, this also doesn't go unsupported. For further, in Peru exist the mysterious Nazca Lines. The Nazca Lines are ancient geoglyphs which are so massive that they are visible fully only up high in the air. They are already theorized by many to have served as landing strips for ancient flying machines or vimanas. So, if Paracas Trident was the compass for celestial beings, then mysterious Nazca Lines exist as a testimony to Sugriv's description of celestial beings, who according to him, lived beyond Antarctica, about which he tells later in this verse. In the end, he says, beyond this, the East is inaccessible. There live gods or devta. Because it lacks sunlight and moonlight, that land is dark and not visible properly. Clearly, he is describing Antarctica. He instructs the Vanars to not go beyond Udayagiri or Andes. The video ends here. Let us know your opinion on the video. Share it with your friends and spread the word. Subscribe for more, and if you like the video, give